Hello and welcome to today's fireside chat on the impact of tech, data and COVID-19 on the future of societies and global communities. So I'm Adam Rowland. I'm the Director of Public Sector Impact here at Public Sector Network, or PSN. I'm joined today by two outstanding guests. First of all, we have Lucy Turnbull AO. Many of you would know Lucy as an Australian businesswoman, a philanthropist, ex-local government politician and public servant. She's got extensive experience that is a little tricky to run through entirely now, but key highlights that relate to this conversation include previous deputy chair of the COAG City Expert Advisory Panel, appointed in mid-2010 and reported in March 2012. Chaired the committee for Sydney from 2012 to 2015, after which she was appointed Chief Commissioner of the Greater Sydney Commission. And also has very strong academic credentials, including being appointed as an adjunct professor at the Faculty of the Built Environment at UNSW in 2016. So welcome, Lucy.
Thank you, Adam. Good to be here.
Thank you. And joining us is Dr. David Bray. It's difficult to avoid the word polymath when describing David. He began working for the US government at age 15. At a high-energy physics facility investigating quarks and neutrinos. Since then, he's served in a variety of leadership roles, from 2001, IT chief for the US CDC, quite timely, leading the program's technology response following 9/11, then anthrax in 2001 and SARS in 2003. Also led the transformation of the Federal Communication Commission's legacy IT from 207 different systems to award-winning tech, and actually received the Global CIO 100 Award twice in 2015 and 17 for transformational leadership in change-adverse settings. Also exceptionally strong academic credentials, including a PhD in the area of knowledge across organisations, information systems and decision analyses. Welcome, David.
Thanks for having me, Adam. Also great to be here with you and Lucy.
Excellent. Thank you. Now, I thought, just get your reflections to start, Lucy, on why is this an important topic? Why is it important that we think about the future of societies and global communities? And why is this something that you're passionate about?
Well, I think the timing is really important. We are in the midst or coming out of a global pandemic, the likes of which nobody living today has ever observed or experienced. There may be a very small residue, but I can't believe anybody would be recalling the Spanish influenza of 1918-1919. So it's an event for which we have little to zero corporate memory of something happening at this scale. It kind of teases out a lot of very important components of our society and the way people live. It has accelerated a lot of events, but it's also some good events and less good events. And I think it's really an important time for us to reflect on what's important about our society and the people in it, how we need to support society and economies moving forward and do it in a well-informed and effective and competent way, but at the same time, an inclusive way.
Hmm. And David, your reflections on the topic as a whole, why is that important for us and why are you passionate about it?
So if sort of building on what Lucy just said, pandemics in the past in human history turn out to be pivot points that change where societies go. She referenced the Spanish influenza. If you think about everything that followed from there, what happened in the 1920s, the United States saw a Great Depression. We saw the buildup for World War II and ultimately World War II and then everything else that followed from there as something that sort of came from the pivot points of Spanish influenza. We saw the League of Nations come and go, and then its aftermath, eventually the United Nations after World War II. So the question is, what are going to be the pivot points that are going to be coming out of COVID-19? And again, it rarely looks like history in the middle of living in it, but these are things that determine the actions that each of us make, whether we're in government, whether in the private sector. And I think what makes this particular era so interesting and challenging is for open societies, things that used to be done just by government no longer are. In some respects, they're either done by the public or by industry, which is a tremendous opportunity. But when something like COVID-19 happens, it's a coordination challenge. In some respects, if you're in a centralized autocracy or a single party system, you can move faster in terms of coordinating your COVID-19 response than you can if you're in a society that separates its public and its private sector, or has multiple parties that differ on how to go forward and do things. At the same time, I don't think any of us in open societies want to give up what makes us an open society to begin with, that we value those separations, we value those different parties, and we have to figure out how can we move at the same speed as possibly centralized autocracies, but do so with more informed interactions with the public, with industry, and across nations. Because again, no longer are, as the COVID-19 pandemic has shown, viruses and bacteria do not stop at geographical borders. And while Australia is surrounded by an ocean, and the United States at least has an ocean on two sides, if all we do is think about things within our geography, then we will fall behind as a world and as societies as a whole.
You forgot one thing that happened after the pandemic, and which came off the back of World War I, was the Jazz Age. The Roaring Twenties were famous for, you know, liberating society, for, you know, actually encouraging at an early stage the participation of women as being more equal in society. So we've got to take the good, and we've got to remember the good and the bad.
And actually, that's very well said. And just real quick, you're absolutely right. Harlem, the rise of Harlem, and so equally, we became more integrated societies. So yes, with great crisis comes great opportunity. So I look forward to see what comes next.
What trends were we seeing pre-COVID-19?
I think we were seeing before COVID-19 a shift to digitization. Organizations, societies as a whole were increasingly trying to figure out how they could make sense of what was going on in the digital form and moving away from doing things through paper-based processes. For government, this meant modernizing IT systems. You mentioned what I did both at the Centers for Disease Control and later at the Federal Communications Commission. Also did work with the U.S. Intelligence Community on this as well. And the challenge is that people were increasingly getting used to interacting with organizations through smartphones and through other types of almost immediate means. Now, of course, not everyone has a smartphone, although increasingly a large number of people are having that. I would expect that what's happened as a result of COVID-19 is the move to digitization is only going to accelerate. And that's going to put the burden not just on government organizations, but also the private sector. If you're not digital already, plans that were probably 5 to 10 years off are now being compressed to 18 months to 36 months to do that. The other thing that I think we were seeing on the downside was there was already over the last 5 to 6 years in the United States and Europe, and I'm sure you probably saw this in Australia as well, increasing misinformation, disinformation. And we've always had misinformation and disinformation to a degree. When I was involved with the response to 9/11, there were conspiracy theories that somehow this was a secret U.S. government plot. It's not, but that was some of the conspiracy theory. Same thing about anthrax, when the anthrax events of 2001 happened, same thing. But what was different, again, is not everybody had a smartphone. Not everybody had a social media account. And so I think what's happened is, while in some respects we're more connected now more than ever, that sort of taking the time to reflect and think before you share something, we now almost have sort of design engagement apps that make us addicted to want to share things. And there's so much information overload that instead of thinking about, does this make sense? Does this logically seem to ring true? We're sort of almost looking at tags. Is this from a journal that I like? Is this from a publication that I like? Is this from a party that I like? And we're not pausing to reflect. And that, of course, creates challenges for open societies because we allow a plurality of narratives. And if we start, you know, saying one narrative is more valid than another or taking it down, then we look like we're censoring or we're being arbitrary in ways that we don't want to be doing. But we obviously need sort of better approaches to misinformation. And then the third thing I think that was happening that's only going to accelerate is the recognition that we may need to do something to balance out the forces of things moving increasingly to sort of winner take all. And what do I mean by that? The good news about the internet, you can compete globally. The bad news about the internet, you can compete globally. And so where in a pre-internet age, you could be the best retail store in a certain region, now because things are internet in nature, it seems to be only one survives. I mean, even if we were to break up, say hypothetically, the largest search engine on the planet and have 10 different ones, I guarantee you in 5 or 6 years, we as consumers would probably only be using one. And so we'd gravitate back to that. And so how do we deal with this world in which winner seems to take all, and COVID-19 may be accelerating that, but at the same time, allow free markets and allow competition to happen across sectors and industries?
The other thing that's happening beyond digitization is, you know, I would say there was actually an article in the FT a couple of months ago, probably, about, might have been even last year, about what was the high point of globalization. His money was on 1999, and he and I think that's right. You know, the 9/11 thing was a track down, and I think this is potentially, although the pandemic is global in its reach, a track down. We are relocalizing. You know, things like supply chains for food and fresh vegetables are getting more local. So that's another factor at play, I think.
If we've been looking at what's happened with COVID-19, even before COVID-19, we knew that our supply chains were optimized for efficiency. But unfortunately, efficiency is not resiliency. And so now when a crisis like COVID-19 happens, they've been broken. And in fact, there are several nations that unfortunately, if they have to rely on food solely within their borders, will not produce enough food. Even if they start fishing or doing other things in terms of activity, they will still not produce enough food to feed their people. Australia, Canada, the United States, we are all net food producers that produce more food than our people need. So this could actually be an opportunity for all of us to actually mobilize and help feed those countries that will be in need. At least in terms of our research at the Atlantic Council, several of the countries in need, yes, South America, Africa, but increasingly also in the Middle East, and in some cases, they're the very nations that were oil exporters to begin with, and of course, oil has crashed, and so they already are facing a financial crisis. Now they're facing a food crisis on top of it. That could create massive instability if we don't reach out to them.
Another area of potential instability is if and when a vaccine is developed for COVID-19, if it's developed in a country which doesn't have a sort of like a sharing approach to how to ration the vaccine across either the nation where it's developed or the world, that could have interesting distributional and geopolitical implications as well.
Agreed. And actually, to Lucy's point, I mean, one would hate to think that somebody might intentionally deprive the vaccine from certain groups of people or deprive even food or personal protective gear, but that could happen. And so those of us in open societies that celebrate transparency will probably need to do something to make sure that the world as a whole is making sure that the vaccine is getting to those who need it, that food is getting to people where they need it, and personal protective gear is getting to people where it's needed, so we don't have genocide by virus being done in certain places around the world.
And what I really hope is that the next pandemic is another 100 years away, but if it's not, and even if it is, I hope we've learned a lot from this.
There's a lot of good that'll come from this in the sense that we will design both cities and rural areas to be more resilient. She mentioned the example of local farming. In the United States, there's a group called Ample Harvest, and what ampleharvest.org does is they motivate local gardeners who usually produce more food than they need to donate their food to a food bank. But what they do is they help time it so that the food bank has predictability when it arrives. They don't have to do cold storage, which is often a problem, and they schedule it. But what they found is they could actually increase the food production of the United States by about 30 or 40% just from local farmers in their own backyard. I imagine the same thing could be done for Australia as well. And so if there's good to come out of COVID-19, we may very well see, I mean, we already know, the data has shown, flour is hard to find, yeast is hard to find, people are baking. So we're going to see probably a net rise in bakers that probably continue even after the COVID pandemic passes. But we may also see a rise in gardeners, much like what happened when the Great Depression happened or what London faced after World War II. Community gardening was celebrated. And so we can engineer our cities and our rural areas to be more resilient. And we need to make sure we do both. Because at least in the United States, before COVID-19, what we were seeing was more than about 49% of all the jobs in the country were being created in just the top 10 most populous cities in the United States, which was not fair for the rural areas. Now, what we may see post-COVID is we already are beginning to see some financial institutions relocate out of cities to the more suburban areas or things like that. And so maybe there will be a push to relocating in rural areas, especially as it becomes more acceptable to work online. But of course, that then, of course, requires broadband connectivity to make sure they have access and everything like that as well. So the future is unwritten, but I hope we build a world that is more prepared, not just for pandemics, but for other crises as well, whether it's climate change, EMP blasts. Hopefully that never happens, but it could happen. For government, this is going to be an interesting question where I think what we should be doing is we should be talking about governance, because governance can be done by government. Governance can be done by the public itself. Governance can be done across industry. And in fact, that's one thing that I think we need to discover soon is how do industry sectors work together? This is an area in which we need to figure out new ways of governing in terms of how do we build trust online? How do we build culture online? how do we work together in a way in which I may never see you for 6 to 9 months, but we need to collaborate effectively. But in terms of governance, I think it's, at least for open societies, it begins with trying to figure out how do you share data in a way that still gives individual choices and gives industry choices. If there's anything that at least we stand for at the Atlantic Council is we're for open societies and for pluralities and reminding people we're stronger together across nations and sectors.
When we were doing our strategic plans for Sydney, we were trying to seek the key performance metrics of how you see if the plans are working, that you are creating a better distributed city, you are creating opportunities across the whole area, and you also inclusive at the same time as you're creating jobs. And one of the performance metrics we identified has actually come into great emphasis in the last couple of months, and that is the ability to walk and cycle around. Now, 15, even 10 years ago, even 5 years ago, walkability and cyclability was considered to be a kind of like a middle class gentrifying kind of, option or, preference. But now I think we realise that the ability to walk and cycle from place to place has enabled us to relocalise when we haven't had much choice. But it's also given us huge opportunities to be physically and mentally more healthy. So we, across society, but particularly in cities, I think we will now, and I hope forever more, will value the ability to walk and cycle around, because it has been so important at this time in so many cities. And the city of Paris has done an amazing job. They've just basically temporarily closed off roads to traffic, and that's a great thing. And I would like to hope that that can happen in a lot of places. There's been some of that in Sydney. That can happen, and that can be sustained, because that will really shift the way people use the cities. But on a more, I guess, a more troubling note for me, is the prospect that this will be a recession, perhaps worse, but it will be a pink recession, and it'll be the first pink recession we've had. In Australia, at least, participation in the workforce by women has never been higher, and they've been more impacted by the recession because of the concentration of female workers in the retail industry and the tourism and accommodation and travel industry. So I really think one of the things we need data to help us with is to identify areas of weakness and means of actually addressing that fundamental inequity, as well as the inequity of non-female workers who don't have the luxury of working from home. I mean, we are lucky. Typically, if you have a college degree or a university degree, it's going to be easier for you to work at home. And so we have to value and appreciate the women and the men who can't do that, especially the ones who work in the healthcare system, in supermarkets, in all the public transit, all the touch points that are actually really risky. We have to value those people more than we ever have. And if we haven't shifted our perspective there, then we're all, I don't think we should be entitled to think of ourselves as members of the civilized world.
Well said, Lucy. And I want to amplify that you're absolutely right, that there probably will be a recession. How long it'll be is anybody's guess. But there's also troubling data that suggests that it'll be lopsided in who experiences it. And I think what you were saying is so true, that even before COVID-19, we were seeing inequities in terms of who was being advantaged by the economy at the time and things that were going forward. And at least in the United States, this was also, not just was it frustration between gender lines, it was also frustration between different racial groups, but also between rural and urban, that the urban side seemed to be going much faster. And I think if there's anything that we need to go in mind with COVID-19, both as just general members of the public, but also whether we're from government or industry, is if we don't think about making sure everybody benefits from whatever the future of work is in the post-COVID-19 era.
What's a key message for someone who might be working in the public sector, maybe in a local council or municipality, maybe in a state government department, or maybe even in a federal government department? What should they take out of this, and what might they want to think differently about or do differently as a result of this conversation?
Well, I think that everybody's going to have to think about, if you're trying to engage people and include people who perhaps find it harder to be members of the workforce, like women with family responsibilities or full-time members and disabled people, I think if we use this as an opportunity for the public sector to reimagine how you can include these people in the workforce, that would be a good thing, because we've learned that flexible working works.
And building on what Lucy said, I think I would give three recommendations that would be tangible recommendations to those that serve in the public sector. First, you should be brave enough, whether you're a supervisor or you're a report or wherever you are, to be able to ask trusted colleagues, why are we here? You know, what is our purpose? Because now is the time to, I mean, we always have our vision statements, we always have our mission statements, but really dive deeper and make sure you don't accept the sort of surface answer, we're here to do X, and just say, really, why are we here? What's our purpose? Because now's the time when you can ask, maybe we can do it differently in a virtual context or through the internet context or in a COVID era. And that allows you to sort of get past sort of, if someone says that's the way we always did it, it was like, yes, but COVID-19 hasn't happened or something like that, that you can actually get some of that legacy thinking. Now, you don't want to throw it out the window, because in some cases it's good, but that's where sort of cutting to the question of why are we here and then where do we want to go is important. So that's the first thing. The second thing is try to build a network of diverse inputs that can change your thinking. If all you're doing is being surrounded by people that are like you, then you're actually holding yourself back. So think about, you know, how do I reach out to either colleagues that are thinking different than I am, people that are outside of my even government agency, whether they be from industry to the public, what is sort of like my brain trust that sort of informs me? Because as it is, we're all working so much, I don't know if we have enough time to read everything, but if you have trusted colleagues that can sometimes ping you and say, did you see this or did you see this, make sure they think differently than you. I mean, if anything, the trouble is the algorithms are linking us with like people, which is not good at all. So make sure you get that contrarian that actually, you know, you passionately disagree with, but you agree, you like the fact that you disagree with them on that. And so that would be the second thing. And then third, data, data, data. I mean, it's been shown, you have to think about not just getting data for the sake of data, but use data to inform your decisions and recognize a lot of doing data is about putting in the right context, which is why one and two is so essential, that you have to understand why we're here. And then you also have to have your professional network, because any data can be reinterpreted in some ways that can shine it in a positive or negative light. But what data does best is it doesn't give you the answers. It gives you the additional questions you should be asking. And I think that's really sort of, we were talking about data literacy. If we start having these data boards or these data ombuds function, they should play a role to make sure, is it a diverse group? Because we already know there's cases where data is not representative of certain parts of the society. Is it characteristic? Can it be used appropriately to answer the questions that we want answered? And then once we get those answers, is it ethical for us to use what the data is showing us? Because it may show certain things, but we may decide that's not ethical or something that we want to do as society. And so if you're not familiar with data, take an online course. Get familiar with it, because that is the future, not just of governments and governance. That's the future of just about everything we're doing. It's a new form of literacy. COVID-19 is a chance to shine the light on the existing fragilities and inequities that were present in society and ideally fix them, because we need to recognize that when we talk about resilience, part of resilience is inclusiveness, is a diversity of views. And in fact, it's been well shown. Diversity, a diverse group, leads to better outcomes, both in terms of experiences and backgrounds, whether it's a board, whether it's a company, whether it's an organization. If you don't have a diversity of perspectives and experiences, you will actually work yourself into a blind spot versus diversity that you can do through inclusion.
Now, that's been not just interesting now, but we now have given the watchers and the listeners some sage advice about how they can go and actually have a greater impact in the world. So my thank you both to you, Lucy, and to you, David, for joining us today for what has been a very insightful conversation. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Adam.